I've been doing this for 16 years. There's not a race that means this much to the city.
Flying Pig Marathon winners, cherishing the race, cheering on our community.
I had a great day. I was in Cincinnati, and there's not much more you can ask for.
Celebrating the Flying Pig Marathon and its milestone moment on this edition of Let's Talk Cincy. From WLWT, this is Let's Talk Cincy, presented by Western and Southern Financial Group. Put our financial strength behind you.
Olympic gold medalist, the great Jesse Owens said, "We all have dreams, but in order to make dreams come into reality, it takes an awful lot of determination, dedication, self-discipline, and effort." Owens was not a marathoner, but his words reflect the hard work of runners preparing for the Flying Pig Marathon. Hello, everyone. I'm Curtis Fuller, and welcome to Let's Talk Cincy. The Flying Pig Marathon is a signature event here in Greater Cincinnati. The race takes place on May 7th along the streets of Cincinnati, Covington, Newport, Marymount, Fairfax, and Columbia Township. As we celebrate 25 years of the Flying Pig, let's go back to where it all started. Kelly Rippon sits down with the man who helped create the course on a bar napkin.
The combination of running and beer and, you know, energy. Somebody said along the way, there'd never be a marathon in Cincinnati. And I guess I'm just the kind of person that's what I needed to hear. And so I said, has anybody ever put together a business plan?
And just like that, the squeals were in motion. After a long run with a Bob Ronkers running group, it wasn't uncommon for runners to meet for post-run drinks at O'Brien's. There, the very first draft of the Flying Pig was created.
The story of the napkin is really about the route. It's about where could you actually do it.
On a napkin, Coughlin and friends sketched out a way to run 26.2 miles around Cincinnati with the goal of highlighting all of our neighborhoods and what they had to offer.
And when we designed the course, we tried to make sure that we went through as many communities as we could, including Northern Kentucky, which we did. And I think that's part of the flavor of the race, is that it's not just going back and forth on a highway. It really is part of the community.
From a napkin to execution, it was a lot of strategic planning, placement, and grunt work to pull it all together. A lot to take on for a man with a young family, young business, and a lot of people saying it couldn't be done. But Coughlin had a motivated group of friends and volunteers. A handful flew out to a race directors conference with freshly printed business cards that read the Cincinnati Marathon, which at the time didn't exist.
I'm pretty amazed at, you know, where it is at this point, from the standpoint of how it's grown even beyond a marathon. It's really a big community event now, but I never start anything without thinking that it can be successful. I'm an optimist.
That positivity and persistence paid off. The Cincinnati Marathon became the Flying Pig. And now, even when he's on vacation thousands of miles from Cincinnati, Coughlin is followed by that little pig that was almost an afterthought but became the focal point of Cincinnati's race weekend.
And I started talking to the guys from Cincinnati. He said to me, "Have you ever heard of the Flying Pig Marathon?" I started laughing. And he showed me a picture that the day before, a woman with a Flying Pig running shirt had been in to this little restaurant bar that had some pigs next to it.
The Flying Pig has grown from the marathon to a weekend of events for people and pets and of all abilities. It also extends beyond the first weekend in May, with Pig Works running multiple races in the city throughout the year. Many on the Pig Works Flying Pig team have been there since the beginning, and they are excited to see the new ways it can continue to grow. Kelly Rippon, WLWT News 5.
And joining us now is Iris Simpson Bush, president and CEO of Pig Works. Welcome to Let's Talk Cincy, and congratulations, 25 years. It's hard to believe it's been 25 years.
Huh? It truly is. You know, Curtis, I'm native Cincinnati, and so to have our hometown marathon to have grown like this is kind of a sense of source of pride for me. But I was involved in 1997, a couple years of planning for the debut in 1999, and I think I can speak for that group of founding board members when I say we thought it was a great idea, but I'm not sure anyone expected 25 years later to have the kind of success in the city, across the country, and actually I think we can even claim international status now. This year we typically get all 50 states. We have 31 foreign countries represented this year. It's just amazing. So many people have the determination, the passion to make it successful, But I don't think anyone's more surprised than us at the at where we've grown, the kind of acceptance it's received everywhere.
And that speaks to the impact that it's had on the greater Cincinnati. I mean, I said it was a signature event, and that it is.
It certainly seems that way. And, you know, we can talk about the economic impact, which is significant and important, of course. But I think there are so many things we do that, you know, the race, first Sunday in May, the full marathon, and then the complement of distances, kick off with a 1 mile on Friday night. So it's become a running festival. It enables people to accomplish their goal, whether it is to get off the couch and run a mile or, you know, put in what it takes to do a marathon. But beyond that, we try to year-round have initiatives in our community that I really believe make a difference. We have a youth program. Pre-pandemic, about 6,000 children. You know, we have a diaper dash. They start crawling, and then we have an incremental program for children 6 to 12. And recently, we've incorporated a way for them to fly up to the 5K from the incremental program. It's about getting them to move, whether they walk or run, but we provide a hog log, and it has a nutritional component. It has a reading component, and so many of the schools participate, and educators tell us they love the aspect of, you know, helping the children develop good, healthy habits and helping to round out their day, round out their lives. Yeah. So that, a scholarship program that was recently initiated that truly rewards high school seniors if they do well in school, if they do well in sports. The honor of a lifetime, Curtis, yeah. And I truly mean that. It was a complete surprise. We did an inaugural breakfast. Recipients thought they were going to get, we have 10 recipients, $5,000 apiece. Bob Coughlin, the Coughlin family, at that inaugural breakfast raised that amount to $20,000 for each of those kids. I was absolutely blown away. I didn't know he was going to do that. And then on top of that, to have a scholarship in my name, to I can't imagine any honor that would have meant more.
Well deserved.
Thank you.
Let's talk about the charities, because so many people benefit from resources of the Flying Pig. Talk about the charity benefit.
Absolutely. And you know, Curtis, that particular model was very unique when we debuted in 1999. It takes, for example, this year, we'll need about 7,500 volunteers. Of that volunteer base, many of those people come back year after year. But what we do, and again, I have to attribute it to Bob Coughlin, the founder, and Stacy Browning, she was Stacy Montagner at that time, Karen Cosgrove, Michael Boylan, just a group of very smart, dedicated people who laid a great foundation for all of us to follow. But that volunteer model was one of the things kind of unique. If a charitable organization brings volunteers, we'll pay a stipend to that organization, depending upon how many volunteers they bring. It is tied somewhat to the responsibilities they're assigned. But that model is now utilized in races across the country, and it was new and very unique here. So that happens. We typically have over 300 charities, charitable organizations involved. You know, when you're raising money for Make-A-Wish or St. Jude, those wonderful organizations, it's kind of easier to tell the warm and fuzzy story. In our case, when the pig was founded, they wanted to help so many worthwhile causes. And frankly, we have all of the big organizations, team and training, you know, Leukemia, Lymphoma, American Cancer, American Heart Association, but it goes down to organizations as small as PTO organizations. Right. We have some Boy Scout and Girl Scout troops, and for some of them, some of the smaller ones, they tell us we're their largest fundraiser of the year. Wow. Well over $1 million is typically raised through the Flying Pig, and the board of directors started another thing that I think is a rather unique concept. It's in the genre of the Rubber Duck Regatta in Greater right. Cincinnati. Everybody knows about that. Well, we have the piggest raffle ever. You buy a pig, it's a $5 pig, and The grand prize is $10,000. The organization who sold the pig gets $5,000. The winner gets $5,000. Second prize is $5,000. And we have a third prize that celebrates Cincinnati. Lots of fun things to do in Cincinnati. But the biggest raffle ever, any not-for-profit can sign up, and they keep 100% of what they raise. I can't tell you how many come in with their tickets or report their online, and they bring us the money, and it's, no, you keep the money. All of it?
All of it.
So our accountant says it's a no-brainer, but it's another unique thing at the Flying Pig.
Well, it is, and it just talks about the impact, and we're gonna talk, you mentioned the economic impact of the pig, and we're gonna talk about that a little bit later in the show, back in a moment.
When Let's Talk Cincy returns.
The people on that course that are cheering you on, like, that reminds you that it is fun.
She is running with a purpose.
I'm only 2 minutes away from it, so I'm really not far off. I know that I'm gonna hit it this year.
The gold two-time Flying Pig winner, Caitlin Keene, hopes to achieve when she crosses the finish swine.
Welcome back, everyone. As you know, the first weekend in May in Cincinnati is known as Pig Weekend. One well-known name is returning to the Queen City and is trying to make history. Caitlin Keene spoke with Meredith Stutz as she prepares for the final stretch of training.
Caitlin Keene is a Flying Pig legend. She's won the marathon twice and most recently won last year's women's half marathon. This year, though, she's got her eye on the history books before a number that goes far beyond 26.2.
We caught up with the 30-year-old on Zoom with her dogs from her home in Texas.
You said March, and I just looked at my calendar and realized that I think we're like exactly 2 months away from the Flying Pig. So that is definitely requiring a little bit of a deep breath. It comes up really fast every single year.
Turns out for as fast as she is, time flies faster. Caitlin Keene grew up in Hyde Park, but now lives in Fort Worth. Coming back to Cincinnati, being cheered on by loved ones brings a personal touch to every Flying Pig race.
I know fun when it comes to running is not really like the word most people would use, but the people on that course that are cheering you on, like, that reminds you that it is fun.
One!
But this year, Caitlin approaches the starting line with two goals. Win the marathon for the third time, making her the first woman to do so, and qualify for the Olympic trials.
I ran a 2:39 back in December, so I'm only 2 minutes away from it, so I'm really not far off. I know that I'm gonna hit it this year.
She qualified back in 2020 and wants to do it again. To do it, she needs to run a qualifying marathon in 2 hours and 37 minutes.
I'm not trying to really go to the Olympics. If I am that fast, that would be great. The Olympic trials for me is really like my Olympics. That's an accomplishment in itself.
To shave off that final 2 minutes and tackle those tough Cincinnati hills, Caitlin is keen on consistency.
If I do it in Cincinnati, like, that would just be the ice, like the cherry on top of the cake. I'm not making that 100% my priority. My goal is to win for the third time.
And if she wins, Caitlin has one specific request.
We need to find a way to get Joe Burrow to show up and hand out finish line medals.
Because you know what 3 squared is?
9. Perfect.
Caitlin says this year she's also running in honor of her grandfather, who just died a few weeks ago. She says she is ready to give this race everything she's got to run it in his memory. Meredith, that's WLWT News 5.
Still ahead, putting Cincinnati on the national and world map. The spotlight the Flying Pig puts on the Queen City.
And joining us now is Dr. Doug Oberding, a Pig Works board member and Xavier University professor. Doug, first of all, welcome. We talk about the impact, the economic impact. Now, you study this. Talk a little bit about what this does for Cincinnati.
Well, so, yeah, this is a very interesting event. You know, when we talk about the economic impact of events like Cincinnati, really what we're doing is we're looking at the spending from out-of-town visitors that's attributable to the marathon. So people who are coming here to run the marathon, and from not from the 13 county metropolitan statistical area. So on average, about 50%, right around 50% of the people that you'll see down here running the marathon and the half marathon on Sunday are from out of town. So that's a pretty big number. And then, and so when we look at the economic impact, we try to count spending in places like hotels, restaurants, bars, retail, transportation. And we sort of tally all of this up and we apply some what we call multipliers, right? And and we get this number. It's about 15 million. This year, we're really excited because I think we are going to see that tick up. Our biggest year was 2019. Then, of course, we had the pandemic. So we've got the survey all locked and loaded. And as soon as people cross the finish line, then probably on that Monday, that survey is going to go out and we'll start figuring it out. Yeah.
I was telling you, my daughter is a marathoner and she's running Hawaii, Italy. Planning to run in New York. I mean, people are attracted to various areas, and Cincinnati has become one of those places that people say, we're going to go there in May.
Yeah, so that's another thing. So we always think about economic impact when you talk about it just with everybody. But there's actually two other ways that this impacts the community. One is a place marketing impact. Right? So the Cincinnati Flying Pig Marathon is one of the most popular marathons in the United States and in the world. So people know that name of Cincinnati because of the marathon. So it's a great place marketing vehicle. The other thing, and Ira spoke to this a little bit earlier, but there's also a social impact of the marathon, right? So the Flying Pig Marathon helps sort of create those networks that bring communities together. She talked about the charities, the schools, the Girl Scout troops, the Boy Scout troops. These are all social impacts that these organizations can use the marathon to strengthen what they do. And so the Flying Pig Marathon is really one of these unique events. There's not a lot of sport events that can say that they're impacting the community in those three ways.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. I would imagine as you present those dollars and cents numbers to businesses, they focus on that. They say, okay, I want to be a part of this.
Well, you know, it is really interesting because if you are walking around downtown that weekend of the marathon, it is there's people on the street. It looks like New York City, you know? If you've been on the streets of New York City, that's what it looks like. People are out, they're spending money. And there's another kind of impact too, which I think is, you know, we don't count it necessarily as economic impact, but, you know, when people come from Anderson Township and Turpin and Colerain and Sharonville to downtown Cincinnati, they get a chance to sample their city. And even that local spending, it benefits all of the businesses in the downtown area and in northern Kentucky and out in Marymount. So the marathon is really an economic engine. It's a social engine, and certainly it's a great marketing vehicle for Cincinnati.
Is anyone you find ever surprised by the economic impact of it?
I think people are surprised because they, you know, something like a marathon, we don't, you know, our runners aren't like a convention. You know, convention comes to town, everybody goes out and drinks. Well, that can add up really quickly, right? Our guys, they're coming here, and our gals, they're coming here. They're resting up the night before, but they spend a lot of money. The money that they spend at the expo and the money that they spend on retail far outstrips what you see in restaurant and bar spending at you know, a typical convention.
Oh, that sounds good. Yeah. Hey, Doug, thank you very much for being here today. We'll be back in a moment.
Still to come, we relive some of the craziest, wackiest moments in Flying Pig history. Let's Talk Cincy returns in just a moment.
Finally today, when you have thousands of people running several miles, you can imagine crazy things are bound to happen. But you can only prepare for so much. Kelly Rippon looks back at some of the wildest moments from the course.
It's a race called the Flying Pig. So right out of the gate, you know, anything is possible. But for race organizers, after 25 years, they've seen almost everything.
Personal records, proposals, personal triumphs, it all happens at the Flying Pig. But it's the unexpected events that stand out after all these years.
To be very candid, I think you remember the things that weren't always planned.
Now, proposals have become pretty common, but this is Cincinnati after all, so we always feel the need to take things to the next level. Why just get engaged when you can get married along the course?
It was one of our local runners who they wanted to get married, and their entire bridal party ran the marathon, stopped in Eden Park, had this lovely, simple ceremony, and finished the marathon. I mean, those kinds of things resonate with you.
What was it like?
Amazing!
And while the race welcomes its so-called streakers who have run every Flying Pig since its inception, it was another kind of streaker who caused a bit of confusion back in 2011.
So one day when I was told there's a streaker on the course, I said, oh,
there's dozens.
Yeah, they're out there. No, this is really a streaker.
It should be noted, he managed to make it an hour running naked. When police couldn't get him to stop, they hit him with a taser. He was arrested and charged with public indecency. Also banned from ever running the pig again. And then there was the year when a fire near the finish line almost ran things off course.
I'm sure I looked like a deer caught in the headlight when the fire marshal said, oh ma'am, we'll just have to postpone you 3 to 4 hours. And I said, we can't do that.
A Cincinnati police officer who had been working with the pig suited up during his paternity leave and quickly mapped out a detour. The updated route had to be cleared by the Boston Marathon officials since the pig is a qualifier. The change made the route a quarter mile longer, and technically, any race over 26.2 miles is an ultramarathon, so anyone who crossed the finish line that year was a newly minted ultramarathoner.
I always say, Ren, not just a marathon, I ran a marathon and then some.
So as race organizers prepare for crowds, weather, and thousands of elated race finishers, don't dismiss their need to handle even the craziest situations by saying, when pigs fly. Kelly Rippon, WLWT News 5.
Well, it really is a wonderful event, and we appreciate what the pig does for Greater Cincinnati. Well, that does it for the program today. Thanks for joining us. I'll see you next time for another edition of Let's Talk Cincy.